everybody, and welcome. The Atheist Experience is live April 13th, 2003. How can I get that wrong? Boy. And the show is sponsored by Atheist Community of Austin, a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and the separation of church and state. ACA holds weekly meetings every Sunday morning, 10:30 a.m. at Hot Jumbo Bagels downtown between Guadalupe and Lavaca on 5th Street, 307 West 5th Street, except for the first Sunday of each month when we have our lecture series in the Mayor Room of the Austin History Center at 9th and Guadalupe. Now, this coming next month, which will be first Sunday in May, we're not going to have a lecture, right?
That's correct.
That's right. It's going to be like board and officer elections. And so the next lecture will actually be in June, which will be Don Baker talking about Christianity as a meme. And he's already spoken to us about memes and memetics before, and now this is going to be sort of expansion upon that.
Yes. Also, a quick note. Normally, we are at the bagel shop on Sundays. This coming Sunday, though, we are not.
Oh, okay.
It is Easter Sunday.
Oh, dear.
And
okay.
So they're being closed.
Yeah, that's...
We don't exactly know where we're going to meet.
Apparently, the Christians have a big holiday that day.
Yeah, something's going on with them. So we're going to have a meeting, I believe. We just don't know exactly where. A couple different choices. I think Michelle's going to get on the email list and drop a note somewhere.
And hopefully let everyone know, which we will. So. All right. Okay. So don't go to the bagel shop next Sunday then. All right. Other ACA events every week include Godless Gamers, which is every Monday night at 7 o'clock p.m. at Russell and Virginia Glasser's house, and Atheist Happy Hour, which is Thursday evenings, starts about 7:30, but people trickle in all night long, and that takes place at Antonio's Tex-Mex, which is near the intersection of I-35 and Highway 183. That's Thursday evenings. That's lots of fun. Okay, elsewhere, the Nonprofits, internet radio show that ran all last year at the atheistnetwork.com website is apparently coming back. They are still hashing it out, the details, exactly who is going to host, where it's going to be broadcast, what if it's going to be back on atheistnetwork.com or somewhere else, what have you. I think that Jeff D. and Vic Farrow are going to be involved, or at least that's the...
Not surprising.
But, but exactly who will be the regular host, I've heard rumors that Vic may host and Jeff will, do it when he's able or what have you.
Okay.
Because, of course, now summer's coming up and that's a big, professionally,
he does
lots of traveling for that. So, but Nonprofits, as we understand, is coming back. They just have to, iron out the details. So in the interim... if you want to hear just what a really great, fun bit of blasphemy that was, visit our website, go to the radio show page, and you can listen to some MP3 files of past episodes from 2002. And the University Atheists and Agnostics, which is for UT student and faculty members, a group hosted by our very own Charles Tabany and well into its second semester, meets every Friday afternoon right there on your screen at Rainy Hall, room 3.102A, Fridays at 4 p.m., and the email address to write if you are a UT student and faculty member and want some information is uaa@mail.utexas.edu, and either, I don't know if it's Charles or Andy Roberts or whoever will get that email and write you back, and so it's great. A very successful atheist and agnostic student group, the first that I know of at UT, in the time that I've been in town, so... And very apparently, really, really, they hit the ground running last semester and have had a great deal of success. So congratulations to them. And let me see. I do believe, what else is coming up? This upcoming Easter weekend, there are two major conventions around the country. Nothing else for atheists to do on Easter weekend, so it's a good convention season.
So we go to atheist convention.
Yeah. there is, in Tampa, Florida, the Atheist Alliance Convention,
which
appears to be the most impressive of the two.
And Michelle? Our co-chair is going to that one.
Yeah, so very jealous because both James Randi and Richard Dawkins are guests at that. And, I can just imagine that would be awesome to just hear them speak in person. That would be a blast. But so sad,
Just... And the other one that's going on is in Chicago, I think.
Right, American
and,
Atheists.
And Dan Baker is going to that one.
Oh, okay.
From the group. The guy who's given the speech in, 2 months?
Right.
A month from now.
Right, okay.
He's going to that one.
So we'll have reps at both. Cons, and so that'll be terrific. Good deal. So, again, I think on our website at atheisttimecommunity.org, on the upcoming events page, on the calendar page, there is information about those two events and probably links if you want to get more information. specific information to the event websites in particular. Okay. Well, let me see. What else haven't I covered? I think that's about it, right?
Okay. From,
yeah. Just I believe so. Other than, you know, atheist-community. Talk, Martin. Come on. You can do it. Atheist-community.org is our lovely website, and you can go there for more cool stuff about us, because we're so neat. All right. It's time for the news, but before we go into it, since this is super brief, I'll just do it, get it out of the way. We do have viewer emails. It's a
cool.
Yeah, it's a regular, well, it's a thing we try to do regularly when we get good emails from people. This is a live call-in show. We take all sorts of calls and never get to everybody because they just back up and back up. So if you try to call in and you don't, or you want to just drop us a line, tv@atheist-. What is with me with our email address? What is the deal with our domain? I can't. Atheist-community.org. That isn't that difficult, is it?
I'll say it again.
Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled atheists. Yeah. Well, that's it. It's at the bottom of your screen. Read it. Don't count on me to read it because I can't, apparently. But anyway, we got a letter from a guy named Jason who is a big fan of us. He says, "Hey, guys, it was nice to see a live broadcast this past Sunday. I've been watching the show now for several months, and I try not to miss an episode. I have to say I salute you guys for what you're doing." Well, thank you, Jason. We salute you back. "I'm an atheist, but I think I would lose my temper on just about every irrational phone call or idiotic question you guys receive on the show. Jason, sometimes it's tough, I tell you." But you know, I mean, I want to, you know, people to understand our points, and, you know. So sometimes you just kind of have to grit your teeth and go, "Oh, no, not that one again." Anyway, he says, "I know you guys probably have plenty of hate mail to read, so I'll go. Keep up the good work." Jason, you know, would that we got more. Sometimes I wonder that we
it
just...
It would be fun.
Yeah, I think we sometimes just scare people off and they don't write us. But anyway, well, thanks a lot. Nice to get some love from the viewers. So, all right. Well, thank you again. So that takes care of viewer emails, tv@atheist-community.org. Got it, is our viewer email address. So, Ashley, news time. What's happening on planet Earth?
Okay.
Apart from, you know, I mean, there is other news other than this war thing that's been happening.
Yes, apparently. So. And we are going to go into that side of the news.
Mm-hmm.
We are a nonprofit educational organization, so we might as well deal with education today, because that's what all the stories deal with.
Yes, Iraq is apparently not the only war that the Bush administration is waging, right? Apparently they've got one going on towards education.
Yeah, well, I think I'm dead. Whatever. Okay.
come on, let's call them like we say them.
We had big words about that before the show started. Not me and Martin, but
okay.
Crew and I.
Ah.
Okay. Anyway, first off, hometown Austin. In less than 60 seconds, the Texas Senate voted Tuesday to require the state's 4.1 million public school students to pause for a daily minute of silent prayer, meditation, or reflection. The measure by Senator Jeff Wentworth from San Antonio also mandates that school districts require students to recite the Texas and U.S. Pledges of Allegiance before the minute of silence.
The Texas Pledge?
Yes, apparently there is a Texas
That's new.
Pledge. Yeah. And it's actually in here. "Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one and indivisible." It sounds very disjointed, but apparently there is one.
Yeah,
"Honor
okay.
the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one and indivisible."
Well, that's interesting that they would require the Texas. I mean, you pledge allegiance to your state first, as if it's some autonomous entity. And yeah. then the country. I mean, yeah. If you're proud to be Texan and your heritage and all that, that's fine. But again, to require
exactly,
it's just
the
puzzling.
State and, yeah.
And again, I don't understand the reason for requiring this
exactly.
mandated moment of silence. You know, it's
exactly.
not like this activity isn't allowed already.
Exactly.
Okay. The only reason it seems for it is so that there can be this public display of saying, all right, we're going to get religion into the schools however we possibly can. And if this is how
this is not for religion. Now.
Yeah. Well, but they, of course, they're not going to come out and say.
Of course.
Right.
No,
but,
course.
You know, this is, it seems to me that is what the intent is. Because, there is nothing, how much time do students have between class? Like 10 minutes? I'm trying to remember when I was in high school. It's about 10 to 15 minutes.
Yeah,
okay.
Thereabouts.
You know? No, there's no big proctor wielding a billy club, you know, keeping an eye on students. If they're praying at their lockers.
Exactly.
You know, saying,
in the hours they have before
school.
Oh,
no, can't do that. No, that's it's completely legal. Yeah. If you want to drop to your knees and pray till you're blue in the face and make a spectacle of
yourself. You get a couple of your fellow students around you to join you.
You can totally, students can totally do that. That has always been legal. It has never been illegal. It's never even been remotely challenged.
Exactly.
The only thing that's ever been challenged is when legislators try to give some sort of public governmental endorsement of it.
Yeah.
So why they think religion needs government endorsement to be somehow legitimized...
Because it's not strong enough to stand on its own.
Can only be explained if there is this intent behind it to sort of, you know, to weave theocracy in more and more to our democracy over, you know, bit by bit, you know.
Yeah.
We've gotten away with this. Now we'll see if they'll let us get away with this.
Which we'll see
if we can get away with this. And they just keep inching, you know,
which I think is exactly what happened in Louisiana. They had no minute of silence. They eventually introduced the minute of silence.
Uh-huh.
And then eventually the kids weren't using it properly. So they started having prayer over the loudspeaker to show them how it could be done.
And then what happened?
And then it got shut down.
Yeah, the lawsuits, bam. Immediately. So they're just setting themselves up for that.
Yeah. So.
They don't want to see the big picture.
Yep. During the 1 minute period, each student may, as the student chooses, reflect, pray, meditate, or engage in any other silent activity that is not likely to interfere with or distract another student. Game Boy.
Take your Game Boy.
Volume all the way down.
Yeah.
Be very careful.
And if the teacher like confiscates it, saying you can't do that during this minute.
Here's the bill.
Ring ring. Yeah, here's my lawyer. Do it. Yeah. I mean, just take care of it.
As long as you don't interfere with anybody, no network games.
You know, I used to be in the comic book industry, and I remember
there you go.
An old comic from, I think it was an old EC comic from the 1950s, and these were the comics that like kind of got comics in trouble. Back in the 50s when there was more of this, you know, fundamentalist intolerance even than there is now. And EC Comics were these incredibly graphic, gory horror comics and this whole thing about corrupting youth and da-da-da. But I remember one. I'm pretty sure this was from an EC. And it was this terrific story about some teacher who was requiring her students to pray in class, right?
Right.
And of course, there was one child who didn't want to participate. And this was causing all kinds of controversy. and I remember there was this very funny scene, like in the faculty lounge, where there was the one teacher who didn't think it was a good idea. And he's like, well, I don't really think that you should have any business, you know, telling students, you know, they might not have the same religion as you, and that's not fair and right. And the teacher's like, oh, well, that sounds like a liberal way of thinking to me. Well, I don't think we need all these liberal commie, you know, tree-hugging commie liberal pinko commies around here like you, sir, and shouted him down and all this, and he withered. And, you know.
And they bought the act and it turned into a gore comic.
And so what happens, the way the story ends, and it's beautiful, is... you know, she gets her way, and this is allowed, and the student who objected to praying stands up and says, well, Miss So-and-so, you know, may I lead the prayer this morning? And she's like, well, sure, Bobby. I'm glad that you're, you know, seeing things my way, right? And so he reaches under his desk, and he gets out this, like, black hooded robe and all these candles and lights them on his desk. And she's like, what are you doing? And he performs this satanic ritual in which he summons a demon that eats the teacher. And it was so awesome. And of course, I guess the moral of the story is, you know, I mean, don't try to impose your beliefs on other people.
Be careful what doors you open.
Yeah, because they just might impose theirs on you. But, you know, this, you know, it always just, but of course, you know, that's the whole idea, you know. Just because you have the majoritarian religious belief, you know, doesn't mean that you can bulldoze over, you know, I don't know if you want to call, you know, today you could do some sort of critical interpretation and have, like, the demon representing, you know, the forces of civil liberties out there protecting the Constitution and what have you and eating all of these theocratic teachers, but it's just...
not the image we're pushing for.
It's just the kind of thing that puts a big fat smile on your face, you know, so... But I don't know. So, but again, what's this all about? Clearly, public displays of piety have proven to be great political capital for you know, candidates, aren't they?
Yep. I can't imagine that anyone would be opposed on these very tough times to let our youngsters take a moment of silence in school and have silent prayer.
They are already allowed to do that.
And this is important, though.
Uh-huh.
That quote just came from Dewhurst.
Uh-huh.
Now, in the next paragraph, or reflection or meditation, Wentworth said. Someone else said.
Mm-hmm.
So one person says, I can't imagine they wouldn't mind him praying. And then someone else cuts in and says, or meditation or reflection, that's okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You
know, damage control?
Well, it's just one of those incautious moments where the mask slips off.
Exactly. Exactly.
Right.
So we're not insisting they pray.
And what's implicit there, too, right? If you are opposed to this, then that must mean you're a bad American and you're unpatriotic
and blah, blah, blah.
So that's, again, that's
considering
how they
it's just following the pledges.
Yeah. Right. So it's always this.
You're an unpatriotic person.
Right.
So just as long as they're quiet for a minute, that's all we're asking.
Yeah. So. Okay. It's never been illegal to do that, ever.
Yes.
You know, it's only ever been illegal for the government to say, you know, you should pray because that's what makes you a good American. Being a good American constitutes having an invisible friend.
Yeah.
Well,
students are in school for what, 7 hours a day? Something like that?
Way too long, as I seem to recall. It just never seemed to be.
7 hours. Yeah, that gives them another,
what,
12, 13, 14, 15 hours, whatever, of silent moments. Mm. Do with what they will.
Well,
So anyway, Texas will soon start having a moment of silence, most likely.
Until the moment of silence turns into a moment of recited loudspeaker prayer, at which point it will get a lawsuit and it'll get a constitutional challenge.
And shot down.
A big mess that would never have needed to happen in the first place if, you know, things had just been left the way they were, which it has worked for 225 years.
Or again, start bringing your Game Boys.
Yeah.
Comic book Game Boys, it's all quiet.
Uh-huh.
So
maybe like a quiet demonic summoning ritual.
I know. Can you sacrifice a chicken quietly?
Yeah. Just shh. Shh. Nothing. sacrifice a chicken breast or something. I can take it for
your lunch.
Sacrifice chicken nuggets. Yeah. You get a very small demon in parts that you have to assemble. All right.
The demonic happy meal.
What else is going on in our nutty world?
Okay. Another education. This one is from the nation's public education leader. Has drawn fire for expressing a preference for schools that appreciate the values of the Christian community. The reason that Christian schools and Christian universities are growing is a result of strong value system, Education Secretary Rod Page said in a story run by the Baptist Press, the news service of the Southern Baptist Convention. In a religious environment, the value system is set. That's not the case in a public school, where there are so many different kids with different kinds of values. Yes, let's not go with all this tolerance
stuff. Yeah.
So,
but like in any civilization, the value system is set. Okay. I mean, civilizations exist. Okay, because people have come up with a consensus of this is how we get together as a culture and a society.
Yeah.
Okay. Now religions come along and they bank on a lot of that, which is has been historically just naturally how it's worked out, right?
Of course.
But then to say, oh well, but my particular way of doing it is the one that
is the better one.
Is better than your, you know, is especially when it's based on something like religious values. Well, what are religious values? Religious values, as far as I can tell, at least from talking to people on this show, is you have this divine authority figure who says do this, do that, you know, and doing this sort of thing gets you into heaven. And helps you avoid hell, and doing this other sort of thing doesn't do those things, and that's what constitutes values. Well, but by the way, I don't have to behave under those values myself.
Of course,
I can do whatever horrible atrocity I want because everything I do is good.
Yes, but everything I do is justified.
I don't see that that's a system of values. I'm sorry. You know, just obedience to authority.
Yeah, blind
just
obedience
for its
to
own
laws,
sake.
Yeah. Is not any kind of moral basis.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Barry Lynn, Executive Director of Americans United for Separation of Church and State, said Page's comments demean students who don't belong to the Christian denominations.
Mm-hmm.
He said Page should apologize for his comments or resign. Mm-hmm. And what Page also had to say, all things equal, I would prefer to have a child in a school that has a strong appreciation for the values of the Christian community, where a child is taught to have strong faith, where a child is taught that there is a source of strength greater than themselves. You are weak. Religion is strong.
Well, also, taught to have a strong faith as opposed to taught good critical thinking? Yeah, I guess I'm sure he would love to have a child in a system like that.
Yeah. Blindly following along. And then, of course, Page comes back to say, no reason to either apologize or resign.
Of course not, no.
He said he intended to convey only that he, personally, would rather have a child in a college that emphasizes strong Christian values.
So, again, I personally wouldn't want to send my kid to any public school.
Well, you know, what he personally wants is immaterial.
Right? Yeah. So, there's another one that's kind of going wacko on us.
Well, yeah, you know. And, so slowly but surely they're trying to whittle away and having any sort of an ecumenical quality to American education. But in elsewhere, right? I mean, what do they do if they can't just like persuade you and kind of wheedle it in, you know, bit by bit by bit so that people become a little bit more acclimated to it? Well, apparently they just resort to pure blackmail.
I don't know. Tell us, Mark.
Here's the situation in what's going on overseas right now, in Iraq right now. This is pretty ugly. There's an investigation going on right now into an army chaplain by the name of Josh Lano. He's 32 years of age. He says apparently what is happening is that he somehow has access to a 500-gallon pool of water over there, where these resources are very scarce to begin with. Okay, and he is only offering this water to soldiers.
Yes.
You know, just either for drinking, for showers, what have you, if they agree to be baptized by him. And if they agree to also sit through, I guess, one of his hour and a half sermons, followed by the baptism, then he allows them to. He says, anyway, there's a terrible water shortage. One question, of course, is how did the chaplain get access to 500 gallons of water, which is unusually large for a baptismal pool, especially in a war-torn nation where, you know.
In the desert.
Yeah. And so the water shortage kept the soldiers from bathing for weeks. One of the investigating officers in the chaplain corps says, he's not sure whether the unit that Lano is assigned to indeed lacks water. So the unit is supposed to be a support unit whose mission is to resupply troops. So they've already got, he's already under orders to supply troops with stuff. And he is essentially superseding those orders.
Yes.
Which I think right there could probably get him. I don't have military experience, but I don't know if that's enough for a court martial or at least for a reprimand or what have you.
Questionable if nothing else.
And saying, all right, yeah, I'll resupply you with water, but you have to be converted first or baptized first. So there's an investigation about this. And in any case, it is just really, really reprehensible. I mean, it's taking advantage of a situation for,
this is a place where there are water shortages. They're in the desert during a war.
Uh-huh.
And he's got the major water supply.
Yeah. And here are soldiers who are putting their lives at risk, to do what they're there to do. And it's just unconscionable that, if in fact, the investigation pans out that this is what's happening, at least a dishonorable discharge is what I would do. But that's just me. okay. So let's see, a few more minutes before the phone calls start racking up. We'll go ahead and put that phone number on the air to just let people start getting in line. What else have you?
Okay. One more relatively quick one here.
Yeah.
More wackos. Not education related this time.
Okay.
This is actually this was from a couple of weeks ago in Pleasanton, California, I believe.
Pleasanton. How very Pleasanton.
Yes,
Pleasanton.
Of course. Yes, of course. And what these people are doing is a lot of people out there, I'm sure, have heard of dowsing. You get these sticks together and you hold them in the right way and your body acts like a receptor, and you can find water and all that kind of stuff. Apparently, they're trying to use that to find terrorists.
Okay. They're using to find this 500 gallons of water that this chaplain is holding.
Exactly. Yeah. they're trying to teach a couple military people on how to douse. And so they can, because some of these things are you go out in the field with a stick and it points to the ground.
Didn't our
water.
Government learn its lesson with the whole remote viewing debacle?
Exactly.
That they spent, $20 million dollars of our money to find out that it was a load of gooey?
And this isn't for water, necessarily.
Yeah.
They're saying they can go to the airport. And maybe you can use it to find the bags with the bombs.
Oh, no.
These people do not know what they're talking about. Dowsing does not work.
Yeah.
In study after study after study, darts would have worked just as well. Exactly. This does not work, people.
Yeah.
Dowsing is not going to find Osama. It's not going to find a bomb.
Yeah.
So any more than walking up to the bags and kicking them.
Which would be more effective, actually. That'll curb Louie. Well, there's
that'll
one.
That'll prove it.
Yeah. It's okay. I have another leg left. I can get at least one more back. Oh, boy.
Yep, I understand the skeptics.
Wait, but the, now, but again, is it the town that's doing this? Is this actually getting sponsorship from the local government or something? I don't think it's a bunch of people?
I think it's a bunch of... It's a group of dowsers who are offering their services. And they are offering their services.
The government hasn't done this. The city military group
basically allows anyone to come in and speak. Because it's essentially a freedom of speech issue. You know, let anybody come in and say what they got to say, even if there are kooks.
So
they're going to bring a couple of these people in and let them talk about it and such.
Yeah.
I don't think it's going to work. Just
well, you know, they can always turn one of those dowsers loose in a minefield and... Well, there you go. If he finds a mine, it works.
You make through it. Yeah. Good for you.
Just sort of like, don't. No. We don't condone that sort of thing.
Would be fun anyway, though.
Oh, well. So, not surprising that I guess we would get this kind of thing. I mean, of course, what happens when you have any sort of major criminal investigation? You get, like, these psychics and people coming out of the woodwork. They're seeing these, these situations.
The 600 psychics that tried to help out with Elizabeth Smart.
All of whom said she was dead.
Well, most of them said that she was dead, yeah. And most of them turned out to be wrong.
But there's just a thing on that's just been reported. Randy reported it, and it's on the Skeptics Dictionary website too. That a situation about a year or so ago when some family, the mother of a family, I think it was a mother, or was it a mother-in-law or a sister? Well, some family had one of their members vanish without trace, and Sylvia Brown went on the Montel Williams show, and Montel Williams is one of these talk show tabloid TV guys who is just been very irresponsible to the public, I think, by promoting these paranormal beliefs. And they got on, and she went on the show and told this woman's relatives, who were, of course, like panicked and freaked out and, you know, in anguish, right, that don't worry, she's fine. She has checked herself into some kind of hospital for some sort of therapy and what have you. And she's there, and when she's ready to come back to you, she, in other words, you know, it's building all this hope. Right. Well, what just happened? Not recently. The woman's body was found.
Okay. Oh, geez.
And it turned out that she had been abducted by someone she knew. She was probably killed within 24 hours of her abduction. Okay. And it is just appalling the way that Sylvia Brown and Montel Williams, built false hope in this is what's wrong with this with encouraging faith.
Exactly.
Okay. It's because when reality slaps you in the face,
touch therapy.
The anguish and the disillusionment thereby becomes like 100 times harder to bear.
Yeah.
Okay.
Or actually seeing things that could help the situation. Again, in hospitals a lot of times they have this touch therapy.
Right.
Where they'll massage your aura and stuff like that to make you feel better. If somebody is going to choose that over actual medicine.
Especially when that was
actual
debunked.
Things that are going to help them. Mm-hmm. And it is being promoted by doctors and done by nurses. Mm-hmm. That's not helping the situation.
Yeah. It was a 12-year-old girl who debunked that.
Exactly. Yeah. Quite well.
So, anyway.
At a science fair in a school.
I'll tell you. All right. Well, we can do this next week. It's not super pressing. But in any event, the calls are lined up. And we have... we're going to go ahead and take them. Live call-in show, 477-2288 is the number to call and ask us questions and talk to us about stuff. And but don't forget, though, that on our website, our lovely website right up there, we have a FAQ page, Frequently Asked Questions page, where we have taken a lot of the most common questions that we get from callers like you on this show, and we've just answered them there on a FAQ page, because sometimes that saves time. But if you check that out and you don't see your question, well, then we'll talk about anything with people. But let's first see what Mike has to say, shall we?
Hello?
Hi.
Hey.
You're on the air.
Yeah, I've seen the show a couple of times, and I really like it. It's a pretty good show.
Thanks.
Especially for public access.
Mm. Well, thanks.
Like, the other day, I just saw this other show where they're just talking about, they put kids on the air, and they're talking about how rap music affects kids and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of think that's a pretty dumb topic, because all the kids were sitting there going, they just, like, were baffled by all the questions on, like, people were asking, like, a 7-year-old, how do you think rap music has influenced your negativity towards society, whatever? And they're just like...
Yeah, they're not equipped to even talk about that.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're too young.
And, like, I wanted to ask you, like, because I don't really know anything about the idea of atheism, and I was wondering if y'all could fill me in on a couple things.
Sure.
That's all I wanted to know.
Okay.
Oh.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Anything
well, like...
specific? Or?
Yeah. Like, what do you have in mind?
Like... I guess, the sort of beliefs of atheism or something like that, I guess.
Okay, well, a general rundown, and, you know, we'll, again, try to... Sorry about the weird sound of the phones. There's some new equipment here, and sometimes they sound okay, and sometimes they sound a little wacky, but we'll just try to, you know, persevere. Generally, a person is an atheist if they don't believe in any gods. And I'd say that, you know, you can be an atheist in regards to specific gods. What I always, you know, tell... Christians whom I talk to who try to invalidate atheism as being any sort of valid position to take is that, you know, the difference between my atheism and a Christian's atheism is a degree of one God. Because Christians don't believe in any gods other than the one their religion tells them that it's okay to believe in. So, you know, if you don't believe in Zeus, or if you don't believe in Shiva, or if you don't believe in the Roman gods, or any of the other Egyptian gods, or any of the other gods of today's religions that exist, well then, where those gods are concerned, you're an atheist. So,
basically, Christians are an atheist in some ways.
Well, in some ways, like, I mean, if you were to ask a Christian, do you believe in Artemis and Demeter, you know, they would say no. And I'd say, okay, well, then if you took a time machine back to ancient Greece, they would call you an atheist because you didn't believe in their gods. So, atheism just means you don't believe in God or gods. And I think that it can apply to a specific concept of God. Beyond that, what do atheists believe in? Well, that's always that's a very common question. Like, well, if you don't believe in God, well, then what's left? And I would say that atheists generally tend to be people, for the most part, who are also humanist, which means that we rely on we think that reason and intellect are the most important, are among the most important attributes that a human being has to guide you through life, and also, human dignity, things like civil rights, you know, the freedoms, you know, civil liberties, you know, the right of people simply to live their lives happily, not being victimized, living life without pain, living life in good health. Just humanitarian concerns are very important to atheists because if, you know, as atheists, we don't believe in any sort of a supernatural afterlife that you go to, well, then life becomes very precious and special and a thing to be valued. Because it's what we have.
So, like, y'all think that, like, there's maybe no heaven or anything? Y'all, like, think you're going to be reincarnated or this is just your one chance and that's all you have?
I don't think that there's any credible evidence to back up the idea of any sort of other supernatural world that a part of your body called a soul that no one's ever been able to really to define or isolate or identify and say that's it, you know, that when you die, this thing leaves you and goes to another plane of existence and you live eternally there. No, I think there's nothing medically or scientifically to back that up, and I think that there's plenty of reason simply to believe that that's a thing. That's a belief that people came up with in order to deal with the reality of death, especially in old times, right? Like in the Middle Ages and before, with ancient civilizations, life was very, very rough and very, very harsh and much shorter and more brutal than it is today. I mean, you were lucky to make it to 25 or 30 if you were the average person, and it was a very, very brutal struggle just to get by in a lot of older civilizations. And it was even worse for women who, you know, as up to the 14th, 15th centuries, and, most women wouldn't make it past the age of 20 or 21 because, like, your first child killed you. So death was always looming and very, very present. It had a very strong presence in people's lives. And so it only stands to reason that a belief in some sort of other world, an afterlife where you, after enduring all of the pain and the horror of this life, you get to go on and it's not all over and there's a greater paradise to live in next. I mean, it makes sense that a belief system in a culture like that would develop just as a thing that comforts people and makes it all a little bit easier to deal with.
It's like, in some ways you were saying earlier about the psychics giving false hope, this is just more false hope.
Well, and it's false hope that probably works a little bit better for most people because unlike that situation where, like, you know, you tell somebody that their dead relative is really alive and then you find out they're dead and then that's a lot worse. The thing about belief in an afterlife, of course, is that nobody's ever come back to say, oops, there wasn't one. you know, so and nobody can really, you know, religion can sell people this idea and, you know, not have to fear somebody.
Yeah, who's going to prove them wrong?
Coming back and saying, I demand a refund, right? So it's, yeah, so it's, and again, I think, and but then there's also, I think, the factor that a lot of people just, for them, finding a belief that's comforting is enough sometimes. A lot of people just don't require that everything be proved to them. You know, I mean, some people, if they say, you know, if a belief in heaven or a belief in afterlife, you know, makes me happy or, you know, that, then that's enough to them and that's fine for them. You know, I don't know that that's always an entirely a healthy thing. If only because what it can lead to are the creation of religions that then become these very powerful political entities and then go out and try to like put down other people who aren't part of the flock. So there's certainly definitely a sharper edge to that sword. But on the whole, no. I mean, I think that, you know, I do what I think it was would be awesome if it were proved suddenly that, guess what, everybody who dies gets to go to this wonderful paradise plane of existence in an alternate universe where it will never end and there's no death and you get all the chocolate you want. And
you get whatever you want.
Yeah, and it's just sort of like, you know, do I think that, I would be like, right on. I mean, I'd be, I'm all for the concept of life after death, but I, you know, my reason and my intellect say, no, I'm also
all for the idea of Santa Claus.
Yeah.
It would be really cool if you do good all year and you get presents out of it.
And there's some guys zipping around going light speed in a chariot.
Yeah.
And another thing, like Santa Claus, not like if people left out because they're not necessarily the right religion to believe in it. Mm-hmm. Exactly. Like Easter and Christmas and all of them have become secondary holidays because they got like Cupid and Santa Claus and the Easter Bunny, mm-hmm. and all these are secondary. So like you don't have to be a Christian just to celebrate Easter.
Right.
You can be anything.
Yeah. But then, you know, the other side of that coin though is that you have the education secretary saying that he thinks it would be better if all schools taught Christian values, clearly implying, right, that Jews don't have values. Buddhists don't have values.
Or at least those values aren't nearly as good.
They're not nearly as good. And
so, not valued as much.
So there's a built-in intolerance right there that is just, I think, reflexive. And, you know, a major official in our current presidential administration can come out, make this blatantly intolerant statement, and then defiantly refuse to apologize or even acknowledge that he could have said anything offensive.
And then another thing is, like, I don't know how people can be so closed-minded in today's day and age about, oh, how is Buddhism against God and such? And I don't know how they can deny it when it's everywhere. They just need to just realize that it's there, and they need to deal with it.
Yeah. Well, they need people. You know, I guess what you're saying is that people need to be tolerant of others. You know, and not be intolerant just because they don't share your beliefs. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I mean, I just don't understand how they can still be intolerant.
Yeah.
Well, because I think that way of thinking is just built into the belief system. And it's couched in such a way to where it's made to seem like less of a nasty thing, because what you're saying is, oh no, I'm not saying this, that like what you believe is a bad thing because I think you're a bad guy. I'm saying it because I really care about you and I'd really rather that you came over to my way of thinking and saw the truth and da 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 da. See, so they couch these and they don't understand that, you know, they'll say something, the other person will take it in a completely offensive way because it is to them. You're essentially saying that you're not as good as me because you don't believe what I believe in, you know. And then you come out and say, well, but that's not really what I meant. I just meant to say that I'm doing this because I care about you. Well, no, who cares? I mean, who asked you? It's intolerant. It's inappropriate.
You never really cared before.
I mean, it's built. Well, but you know, again, every religion's main focus of interest, I think, is to get more people into that religion. So, you know, it's not that they not care, they don't care. It's like what they care, they think that, you know, being just like them and being part of their club is the thing that will help you avoid some evil, avoid torture in the afterlife, avoid hell, do this, do that, and make you a better person. And, you know, they find it very hard to think outside of their own parameters that way. But anyway, listen, we appreciate you calling and asking us all these questions, but, you know, I think we're a lot of time and we got a whole bunch of guys to, you know, on the line after you. So we're going to go ahead and take some of them, but it was good to hear from you. All right?
Thank you so much.
Take care. Okay. Bye-bye.
Thanks, Sean.
All right.
On a little side note.
Sorry about the phone sound. Yeah. Go ahead.
On a little side note, I think it was yesterday, on Saturday. Mm-hmm. They had the Safe Place.
Oh, yes. Walk. Right.
And we had a couple people from the group down there, Michelle, Mm-hmm. And so Michelle was by herself for a few minutes holding the banner,
mm-hmm.
Atheist Community of Austin. And a lady came up to her,
mm-hmm.
and she was, you know, she sounded all kind of, you know, happy and, mm-hmm. oh, hi, how are you? You know, are you down here with a group and all this kind of mm-hmm. stuff? And so Michelle, you know, explaining, yeah, you know, we're down here, we got a couple people, not too many people can make it, da, 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 da.
Mm-hmm.
And then before the lady walks off, you know, she just looked like she was getting more and more upset, you know, when Michelle was talking. And finally, at the end, she kind of grabbed Michelle's hand. And that's when she realized how mad she was. This lady was, like, literally shaking with anger and said, well, God bless you, and walked off. So apparently they had a couple strange people down there. I mean, when they were walking, they had the sign.
She couldn't handle the fact, right, that there were a bunch of atheists out there.
Whom she is allowed to be out in public.
Yeah, whom she is predisposed to think are horrible, evil people. And yet there they are, and there's a bunch of atheists down there supporting this Safe Walk program.
Yeah.
Which, that's what it's called, right?
Safe Place,
right, which is to support battered women.
Exactly.
Right. You know, and she couldn't wrap her mind around that. Just like, atheists out there doing good things and being good.
Can't be.
Yeah. What's up
with atheist bad?
Bad. What's up with that? What you talking about, Willis? So, yeah. That is so funny. That's so funny. Well, I remember when.
Another guy rolled down the car window and said, Jesus is Lord. Scream that out the car.
And.
okay.
Mm-hmm. And. And? it's like, and?
And it was pointed out that we as atheists have never felt compelled to roll down our window when we drive in front of a church and say, there's no God!
No, we just get on TV and do it. So much more effective. Yeah. That's you've never, just, when you've been in the presence of like people, if there's like a Christian in the group, you've never just wanted to, yeah. There's no God. There's no God.
I do that anyway.
Am I bugging you? All right. Now, you know, I remember when we had the protest about a year ago with the National Day of Prayer. And, you know, just a few of us standing outside of the road signs. And Manda, one of our members who was protesting, would say that, like, some people would roll their windows down and say something like, God bless you, or, that would be it.
Then you sneeze.
Yeah. And her response was something like, you know, may a pink unicorn bring you lots of candy. You know, which is just, you know, hey, as long as we're wishing supernatural goodwill on each other, let's just, you know.
Why not make it interesting?
Yeah, exactly. Okay, who's been waiting? Thomas has been waiting patiently to see what he has to say. Hi, thanks for calling. You're on the air.
Hi, Martin and Ashley.
Hey.
I've been watching your show for the last few weeks. And, really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed the discussion going on.
Well, thank you.
I just have a question. I often think of this myself.
I'm so sorry about this sound. I don't know.
Sorry.
Yeah. If you can speak up a little louder, and that'll maybe offset some of that. Yeah.
Okay. Is that better?
A little bit. We'll manage.
Keep going.
We may have to repeat your question to the viewer, but we'll manage.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, just go ahead.
Just continue.
Just go ahead.
Okay. My question was, I was brought up in the Church of Christ, and, you know, I see on your screen there, there's skepticism is virtue, and, through my life experience, I have come to find out that many of the Church of Christ's teachings are totally irrelevant. However, I was wondering, and I have this debate in my own head, what will you think while you're lying on your deathbed? What do you think that will happen to you after death?
After death? Well, I don't think nothing that I'll be aware of. Okay, they'll probably wheel my body out of the room and perform a postmortem and then, you know, do whatever. Bury me or do whatever is done. I don't think I'll have any awareness after death. I mean, I think that what will happen to me when I die, right, is that the, you know, the electrochemical processes in my brain that make up my consciousness will stop. And that will be it for me. So unless, of course, between now and that time, you know, advancements in, you know, life extension technology help. And, you know, so, I mean, it's all science fiction right now, but there are people who are working on the idea of genetic treatments to extend lifespan. I don't think any of it is within immediate reach, but barring something like that, barring something that allows my consciousness to maybe either be stored in some sort of suspension or, you know, something like that, barring that, I think that that will be what will happen, you know. And what will I say on my deathbed? I hope I say, it's been a great life.
Yeah.
And, you know, and if I have a bunch of people sitting all around me, I'll either have fun bitching them out, because what can they do? No, I mean, I'll just, you know, I hope that, you know, I mean, the intent is to be able to look back at everything and say, I've enjoyed it, it's been terrific, and I hope that, you know, I have brought some positivity into the lives of others, you know, that I've known and who've been around me, and just don't throw me to the fish or something. That's
but you know, I mean, you just no regrets, and you end up dead and bloated.
if you want,
we tend not to focus on that part.
Yeah, but then again, you know,
that's the reality, right?
Isn't that the best that I mean? You know, I mean, the best that you can hope for by your death is that you, in the end, that you will have lived the best life you could have lived, and that you don't have regrets, and that you have made the best of it, made the best of your time here, not just for yourself, but for whoever else's lives, you know, shared, you know, you shared.
Okay, I mean, guys. Thank you very much.
All right. Well, thank you.
Bye-bye.
Yeah. It'd be kind of nice to know that other people who I've shared the life with have looked back on my memories fondly.
Yeah, sure.
And they remember me well.
Yeah.
So
might be a good time to just just toss this in really quickly.
Okay.
Some bad news in the cloning realm. Current attempts to clone primates they've all been utter failures. I mean, you know, there have been cats and sheep, and then there was that calf that was cloning. Cloning is fraught with problems right now.
Yeah.
Which is why human cloning is completely unethical at this point, because we know from doing it on animals, it's just fraught with problems. But furthermore, now what we found is that the reproductive cloning of primates, including humans, is unachievable using current techniques, apparently because the primate biology, when cells divide, there are very, very basic things that are supposed to happen, and they're just not happening when they're trying to clone, do reproductive cloning of primates. Using antibody tags, the team has tracked proteins and DNA within the cells as they've progressed. The researchers have found that the cells' mitotic spindles, which help separate and align the chromosomes, were not functioning properly. Some cells had too many chromosomes, whereas others had too few, and moreover, the spindles lacked two proteins, crucial to proper functioning. One of the study scientists said, I don't want to say this will never happen. Given enough time and materials, we may discover how to make it work. It just doesn't work now. Now, of course...
But with any technology, it's never perfect right off the bat.
Sure, but it still proves, okay, first off, that there are massive amounts of hurdles to overcome.
Of course.
And that these Raelians and whatever kooks are out there all saying that they've already cloned a baby are just a bunch of big fat liars who have found ways to successfully exploit the media. I'm freezing in here. Are you cold?
Yes.
It is.
Yes.
It is just insane. I mean, it sounds like I'm talking like, I mean, it's really, don't get it. But now, of course, this is talking about reproductive cloning, which I still don't think anyone really advocates for use in human beings. But it's still, I mean, if reproductive cloning for primates and humans, well, humans are primates, but, you know, it follows. If reproductive cloning is a problem, you know, therapeutic cloning is also a problem.
Yeah.
And that is a problem because it is in therapeutic cloning research where we are looking at a lot of the technologies that we're anticipating will spring into being in the 21st century that will improve the quality of life for people, help us, you know, get immunity. I mean, it'll improve our immune systems, help us get immunity to, you know, cancers and degenerative aging diseases, and even life extension.
Exactly.
You know, the idea of being able to just go right into the genome. And, you know, there's no reason why you can't set it up to where...
Get a booster shot every 20 years and you'll live forever.
Yeah, and so to where people can live for potentially centuries on end.
Yeah.
But that's, again, this is, you know, Hasn't put it put the kibosh on it forever, but it's a significant hurdle. But that's what science is all about: it's finding these hurdles and crossing them.
Exactly.
So yeah, I mean, but I think it would be great if, you know, by the time I was 70, you know, people like, Eureka, we got it. But you know, if it doesn't happen, it doesn't happen. But in any event, if you want to live forever, though, I mean, it makes more sense to go ahead to support and pay attention to actual technologies that are in the research phase towards life extension and what have you, than it does to just sort of put faith in some supernatural panacea that's going to waft you away to some, you know, otherworldly happy land where everything's great. Okay, Paul is on the line now, and again, we're going to try to overcome this weird phone warp system thing that's happening with the sound. We're sorry about it. Some Sundays the phones seem to work, but today we're having problems, so we'll just have to endure. Paul.
Yes.
Hi, you're on the air. Thanks for holding.
Hey, I just want to say I appreciate your show.
Thank you.
The opinions you guys have are good to hear.
Well, thanks.
I want to ask a question, and it's in the area of evolution and evolution of humanity.
Okay, if you could speak up for us to try to overcome this bad sound distortion we're getting on the phones, that'll help us understand you better.
Sure.
Okay.
Okay. I want to find out if you've spoken to people or if you have some opinions about what it is special about the human race that's been able to evolve so far beyond any other animal on the planet. So, for instance, I've heard theories about the Big Bang of the brain. Stephen Hawking, for instance, talked about how language and how that has differentiated us from other animals.
Yeah.
So for instance, other animals, basically, they can perpetuate their life experiences only through instinct, from what I can tell.
Yeah.
They can't carry on anything from generation to generation like humans can.
Actually, they do, but...
Yeah,
I just kind of want to hear if you can tell me.
Yeah, well, like we're not really the authorities to go to on that. We can point you towards the talkorigins.org web archive, where there may be some information on that particular aspect of evolutionary study. But yeah, I mean that is a very, very active, as I understand it, area of evolutionary study that a lot of people are really, really interested in looking at. I mean, in fact, in the last few years, there's been a whole new field arise where they called evolutionary psychology, which is all about how people got to where they think and why they think the way we think and all of that sort of thing. So I don't know. I mean, intelligence is our niche. I'm not qualified to say exactly how we got it, but I do know, though, that there are other species of animal who do also possess intelligence to a certain degree. Why it is that we ended up at the top of that chain, like I said, I think that's all still, that's still an open field there where there's a lot of activity going on right now. But I can't, unfortunately, give you any sort of a definitive answer saying, you know, scientists say it's this, because I don't really have that information. But, you know, you might find some interesting essays there that could fill you in.
There are a lot of people that are always trying to find out what it is that makes humans humans versus, you know, really... you know, intelligent chimps or something like that. Mm-hmm. And it used to be, you know, tool use. We're the only animals that use tools. Well, now we find, you know, some birds do it.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's hardly unique to us. Well, we're the only ones that have language. Well, there are some animals that have, you know, primitive forms of communication. Well, we're the only ones with any form of culture. Well, no, we're not. We've actually found some, you know, primates and chimps and stuff like that that do have social norms and things that are specific to this, you know,
They have essentially an ethical...
The human race has the ability to build on past generations. So, for instance, you know, that we had cavemen that had simple tools, like some other animals, you know, may have simple tools now.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
But we've built on that, and we've learned from previous generations to now that we have the space shuttle, which is the most complex machine that man's ever created. And it's just... try to understand how that could possibly be the way we've so dominated.
Yeah, I mean, because it's interesting, because it's clearly, I mean, evolution is not this a very common misunderstanding that creationists have about evolution, is that they try to view it as this process that has some sort of
goal
in mind, and then they attack it on that basis. But of course, you know, evolution just works with what it has, and of course, it doesn't always lead to, you know, up you right. It doesn't lead you always up the ladder to some sort of intelligent result, because of course, what you know, dinosaurs existed on the Earth for something like 165 million years.
Most of the branches of evolution right now are.
We've
not
been here 1 million. So. Yeah. And for something like 90-odd percent of the time that there's been life on this planet at all, it was all microscopic.
Plankton.
Yeah. So, yeah, that is why it is such a vibrant and an active field of study. First biologically understanding how we got from, you know, our ancestral past to where we are now. But now the development of intelligence and what the implications of that are. It's quite challenging to figure out. Now, is it possible that we just got to be the way we are because there was some sort of divine source of bestowing intelligence upon us and saying, there, you're the ones I've made in my image, so be intelligent and glorify me? And, well, I guess so, but, you know, it's...
Well, I kind of think that the more likelihood is there is... Obviously, there is something. There is what's been termed as the big bang of the brain, and something changes at a certain point to take us off the track of all the other animals that inhabited the earth into something beyond just a regular animal.
Yeah.
And anyway, but I'll look into that talkorigins.org and find out. I'd like to comment a little bit on your subject about genomes and genetics, and I sure hope that doesn't work, because we'd have a serious overpopulation problem, I think, if everyone could live 200 years.
That has actually been a matter that's concerns. Been addressed by people like in who are in the transhumanist community, which is the community that's sort of arising behind this whole idea of radical life extension, the idea that we have a responsibility to help ourselves out with technology. And there's a possibility that overpopulation could become a problem. But then, of course, what you're looking at is the idea of, you know, leaving the Earth and, colonizing elsewhere and just spreading out from our little cradle.
This may bring us full circle. Since you can see the possibility of something like this, and the fact that our solar system is so vast and the universe is so vast and there's plenty of potential for other life forms on other planets, and you basically just alluded to that could be the human race's potential to eventually colonize other planets. Yeah. Is it not possible that big bang of the brain was some other being that colonized us in a way? They basically, they didn't really do anything in terms of our evolutionary physical evolution, but they did change our intellect in some way. They
kind of like those big black slabs in 2001, the Space Odyssey.
I'm totally with you when it comes to the supernatural. I believe everything has a scientific basis to it.
If we discover that, that has been the premise of a great many terrific, awesome science fiction stories. If we ever discover the least bit of evidence that we were seeded by some, interstellar traveling species that just wanted to give us a nudge, well, that will be a hell of a discovery.
Yeah.
And it'll certainly upset the apple cart where established religions are concerned. But right now, I don't think there's any reason to conclude that any more than there's any reason to conclude a supernatural explanation, because, of course, until the evidence is there, you know, all we've really got to go on is what we have got. And I think that, that answer, that speculation is similar to religious speculations in that people have a natural tendency to want to explain things in human terms, right? Like, as intelligent beings, right, we do things with a purpose in mind. We design things for a specific function. And so when we see things around us in the natural world, we just extrapolate how we do stuff to how nature operates, because that just seems to make sense, even if it may or may not always be the case. And so I think if you were going to speculate upon some other galactic civilization, causing the spark of intelligence to arise in us, then you have a whole other field of questions that arise, and just like a religious answer, it raises more questions than it answers, because now you have to think of, oh, well, my goodness, where are these aliens? Why did they come here? What was in it for them that they should help us out in this way? Where are they now? Da 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 da. And they're all this, it's all the same questions that you would get if you were to speculate a God. Well, God created everything. Well, what is this God? Where does he exist? How does he create things? Why did he create the universe? Why can't we see him now? And how do gods do stuff? And where did he come from? So it's when you try to solve a mystery with a mystery, you're not really getting anywhere. It just if at some point we go to the moon and dig up a crater and there's that black slab, then at that point we'll have a good reason to think of that as a possibility. But until then, science will just keep investigating what it's got. But we appreciate your call. We're going to go on to some other callers, and thanks a lot. It's always good to hear from folks who are supporters of the show, and call us back again, hopefully sometime when the phones aren't all messed up, okay?
Okay, you bet. Thank you.
Thanks, man.
Bye-bye.
Going back really quickly, though, to what makes humans special over the animals, some of the talk I've heard about that is the fact that brain power versus being bipedal, walking on two legs. Because when you can walk on two legs, that means you got your hands free. Now you can pick stuff up and start moving around, moving stuff around in the world. And that will, in turn, help brain growth.
Yeah. And then also, if you're bipedal, you are slower than a quadruped.
Yes.
So if a cheetah is chasing you, you're kind of screwed, unless you can think of a way to get out of it.
Exactly.
So
it requires a bigger brain.
So, the development of, self-awareness, first off.
Yeah.
And then of abstract thinking. This is, but what's interesting is that it does seem to be, the threshold seems to be getting pushed back historically.
Yes, definitely.
I believe I read something recently. I don't have the article here, but there's something to the effect that there has been some evidence in some Neanderthal digs, Neanderthal sites, giving evidence of abstract thinking in play in terms of like art objects that were discovered or something.
Yes.
And it is from a much older time frame than they had before. And we know that Neanderthals had a pretty good degree of intelligence. We know that they probably even had belief systems.
Yeah.
At what point that first arose in early primates or early hominids?
Yeah.
Is a matter of great interest. And
I don't think it would be anything really solid and concrete that you could find. I think anything that you find is just going to be a variation on what chimps do now or something like that.
It's just like I said, but we're not the experts on that subject, but I'm sure that there are...
When you start getting really detailed like that...
We'll try to get one on the show one time. How's that? Dig up some... Or we'll just bring a chimp on and he'll...
There you go.
He'll explain everything to us.
Let him field calls for a time.
He'll explain everything to us. We're still just now, figuring out how biologically a lot of evolution has panned out and has worked to develop organisms. Just from a biological standpoint, now the whole the evolution of intelligence and psychology is and how that influenced the development of culture is still wide open and brand new and learning new stuff all the time. Line one is Michelle. Let's see, is this our Michelle or another Michelle? We'll find out. Hey, you're on the air.
Hello.
Hi.
Hey.
Yeah, I wanted to talk about what y'all were saying about psychics and false hope.
Uh-huh.
And it's really kind of stupid in the fact that, Miss Cleo or whatever she calls herself.
Mm-hmm.
I called in there one time just to see if they're actually for real.
Uh-huh.
And I had told her, I didn't even tell her anything off the bat. And she started saying that, oh, your mother's coming through to me. And I'm telling her, hey, my mom's sitting right next to me. And she she just kind of thought saying that she's not going to die for a while and she's okay. And I told her, I'm sitting here and I'm like, I can ask her myself. What's going on?
It would have been interesting to see what she would have, that psychic would have gone on to say if you hadn't told her that your mother was sitting right next to you. It would have been...
If you just feed her on and say, she's happy in heaven, she wants you to know that she loves you, and then, hang on a second, here's the phone.
Yeah.
I'm her mom.
That would be a lot of fun. I should try that next time.
Yeah. Yeah, that would... but of course, that was that whole thing, of course, was just a big phone scam.
Yes.
And they got prosecuted and taken off the air.
They had to pay back about, I think it was somewhere in the order of half a billion. A billion with a B, yeah. Dollars.
Did they have, was it that much?
Because
I knew that they had,
I want to say so.
Mrs. Cleo's,
extraordinary.
Because they had gotten fined.
Yes.
You know, several, like, in a state-by-state basis.
Yeah.
And, but these were like $25,000 or $200,000 fines, something like that.
Okay.
Which is no great shakes to them, because I think it was estimated that in a year, yeah, the business brought in something like $400 million or some crazy,
yeah,
sum like that.
Yeah.
And, but a lot of that was from fraudulent billing, which is what they ended, yes, up getting them for.
Yeah.
People were just being billed for time that they weren't authorizing, or they just weren't spending on the air at all.
Yeah.
They were just fraudulently billing callers, so it was horrible.
Yeah.
And also, I one time bought a pack of tarot cards just to, like, uh-huh, make a quick couple of bucks off my friends.
Uh huh.
I got them and it was really funny. I didn't even know anything about them. I didn't want to read the little book. It took too long. So I just, like, looked at the picture and thought of what they meant.
Uh-huh.
And, like, most of the time I just arranged them in any order on, uh-huh, purpose.
Yeah?
I got them in my favorite order just to, like, tell a stupid story.
Yep.
Why not?
And since I already knew a lot about my friends, it was always correct. And so I always made about $5 a pop, and I got about... $70 off that. It was pretty fun.
Yeah, sweet. Yeah. Yeah, why not? I mean, you know, it's all made up anyway. I mean, just do your own, say,
you
technique.
Can tell them what they want to hear.
Yeah,
sure.
Which is what it's about, isn't it?
Of course, yeah.
Yeah.
They're going to try and fit whatever it is that they hear into, mm-hmm, their own life. They're going to do, yeah, whatever they can.
And I like a lot of parodies that play on it. Like, I was, mm-hmm, watching a show last night, and,
uh-huh,
they were calling her Psychic Lady, and it was like this old lady came out, and she was like, oh, I'm feeling a strong presence, your dog died. He goes, I don't even have a dog.
There, what do you
were,
see?
Yeah, and they were just making fun of her so much. It was, uh-huh, just so hilarious.
Oh, have you seen the South Park episode where they go after John Edward?
Oh, he kept on going, you douchebag, and yada,
yeah,
yada, yada.
Yeah,
that was so funny.
That was the best one they've had since that Pat Robertson episode a long time ago.
He walked through his little archway in his house.
Yeah.
Everyone.
Yeah, yeah, well... You know, that's really funny, that story about, you and your mom and the Cleo people. That's great. I'd say, you know, keep out there and really, you know, poking at them. But I'll tell you one thing, though, before we go on to our next caller. It's fun to laugh and goof and make fun of these people, but there is an extent to which I think they really are bad and they're very harmful. And that is when you take, like, the Elizabeth Smart situation, or any other case where you've had like a murder or a kidnapping, like a missing person, and here you have this family that's in anguish, right?
Yeah.
And then this psychic comes out of nowhere, all right?
And tells them what they want to hear.
Well, even or not even that. I mean, if they tell you, like they told the Smarts,
yeah,
okay,
true,
your daughter's dead, and here's, yeah, the ravine where you'll find her body, which, you know, is, you could say, well, that, you know, and at that time, I mean, you know, that's not necessarily unrealistic to suspect that a kidnapped victim's going to be dead, because that is what happened most of the time.
Yeah.
You don't usually get weird religious kooks kidnapping them to be surrogate wives or whatever. You know, even that is, you know, as a class, Mark Class, well, that phone is just, Mark Class was, that sounded obscene, actually. Who founded Class Kids and had like a, what's it, Polly, you know, his daughter and everything. And he has this whole page on his website about,
yeah,
you know, this psychic came out of nowhere and was exploiting, you know, my family's anguish and the disappearance of my daughter just to, you know, further themselves in their career.
Yeah.
You know, just to get publicity for themselves and to get attention and, you know, to advance, you know, themselves and what they were wanting to do, yeah, in the public eye. And that, to me, is, that's really what, you know, what are these people? You stop making the jokes and you really start attacking them at that point. But anyway, thanks for your call.
Hey, and, hold up. Well, another thing that was really funny, on another show that made fun of John Edward,
uh-huh,
like, the guy came out and he was missing, like, 8 teeth.
Uh-huh.
And it was just really funny. He was being so stupid.
Uh-huh.
And like on the show, he was like, oh, someone's talking to me, and everyone just started laughing at him because they knew he was lying. And I don't really believe in that stuff. I mean, uh-huh, I just bet like they had people fill out information cards in the beginning, and,
uh-huh,
yeah,
he just,
yeah,
plays off those.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's not, and as I understand it, the studio is mic'd. He's got people in the control room taking down information and all kind of stuff. So, and then of course it takes them, what, like 6 hours to tape 1 half-hour show. So there's lots of creative editing to make it look like he's getting it right when he didn't in reality. So anyway,
like the street magic shows is the same thing. Like,
yeah.
You
yeah.
only see the success stories.
Yeah.
Some of
yeah.
them are like, they're talking to people like, think of a number, yada, 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 and I'll guess it. And mm-hmm. they only show the correct ones.
Yeah.
When in turn, they showed like 50 million ones where he got it wrong.
Yeah. 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 You don't hear about those.
He only guessed on statistics.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And also people tend to forget that too. They
yeah.
forget it when things don't come true. Whenever they have a psychic on TV and they see a prediction of something or other, they may hear 10 predictions, but the one that comes true is the one that they remember. All the rest of them they just forget about.
Yeah.
Because they're not reminded of it.
Yeah. Or it's just it's because of the desire that you want this to be right. People deliberately they'll just filter it out. They'll remember the hits and they'll forget the misses.
Yeah.
Okay. And no one is no one ever pointed out that there's not a single one of these tabloid psychics, of whom there are dozens and dozens,
yeah.
If not more, predicted with their big predictions of 2001. Okay. None of them got that World Trade Center thing.
Another stupid thing is I don't know how they can make all these end of the world predictions.
Uh-huh.
And there's also this other one that I heard that mm-hmm. I don't know. A lot of people that I know think it's true that since the Mayans made the first calendar,
uh-huh.
they ended up stopping at December 12, 2012.
Yeah.
And a lot of people think, oh, the world's going to end. We only have like 8-9 more years to live. Oh, no. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, that
just shows that the Mayans were sick of doing the calculations.
They got bored.
They decided to stop.
But, that's been, again, that's been an aspect of religions
probably
now for thousands of years.
Nobody just cared, so they just, whatever.
Predicting the end of the world, because that's a thing that scares people into the pews.
It'll make money, come on.
Precisely.
It'll make ratings.
Yeah, exactly. Well, listen, we're going to go ahead and move on, but we appreciate hearing from you, and thanks for sharing all your funny stories with us.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.
Thanks for calling.
And call again.
Of course, one of the worst ones out there. I haven't actually seen it. I've been meaning to watch it sometime, just see what it is. The animal psychic, or the pet psychic.
Yeah, that disappoints me because it's like when you have like the Discovery Channel and these TV networks people are trusting these to be educational television.
Exactly.
And what you I've really gotten disappointed in. I've kind of abandoned the History Channel. It used to be my favorite channel, like back in 97, 98.
Yeah.
But now they have increasingly shown this propensity to to promote this paranormal and pseudoscientific concepts because I guess that gets the tabloid crowd in and gets the ratings.
It's what gets the viewers in.
Yeah, so. And so it seems like they just can't show a documentary on ancient Egypt without some bozo like Graham Hancock popping out of the woodwork and talking about ancient astronauts and science needs to take stuff that it can't prove seriously too. And it's like, dude.
No, it doesn't.
You have no credentials, other than you sold some stupid best-selling book, and no academic validity to your points of view. So just shut up. Good grief.
So you can prove something, get out of our hair.
Yeah, Skeptics Dictionary is just a terrific and very fun website at skeptic.com, where, they tackle a lot of this stuff head-on. Yeah.
And actually, separate from that, they have the Skeptics Annotated Bible.
Mm-hmm.
And apparently there is a group out there, a website, where they have a retaliation. Can't think of the right word against that.
That's probably exactly what it is.
Basically, you go through 450 different Bible verses that are brought up in the annotated Bible and say why they're not really contradictions, why they're really not that bad or anything else.
Yeah.
By saying it's taken out of context or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I got that advertisement in the email.
They spammed you?
Yes. Well,
okay.
Well, only partially. I actually did. I actually got something from this website a long time ago.
Uh-huh.
They had an interview between Dan Barker, I want to say.
Hmm.
Dan Barker and the guy who runs the website.
Mm-hmm.
And I got an audio copy of that interview.
So the rebuttal to Skeptics Annotated Bible.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yes.
Huh.
And so just, I guess I'm on their email list.
Okay.
And so this is like the first email I've gotten from in like 6 months.
Hmm.
But still, I thought that was kind of funny, but
yeah,
they're actually asking for money for it, and I didn't want to pay for that.
Well,
so.
No, but I've found that one thing about believers, right, is if they don't want there to be any contradictions or anything about their belief system that is unpleasant or embarrassing, then There just won't be.
There will be some big mental hula hoops that they go through.
Sure. So. And, great case in point is that whole 2 Kings 2 verses 23 and 24 exactly. thing that we like to throw in people's faces every now and again, much to their chagrin. And how do they spin that? They were like, oh, it wasn't a bunch of children that were massacred by the bears. It was teenagers. They were youths. Yeah. Whereas, the same people who say the Bible must be interpreted literally. Don't want to interpret that passage literally, where in the King James Version, it's like, and as he was going up by the way, children came forth from the town and mocked him and said unto him, go thou up, bald head, and he turned to them and cursed them in the name of the Lord. And two she-bears came out of the forest and tear 40 in two of the children. I mean, those two verses use the term children twice.
Yeah.
But one defense you always get against that passage is, they weren't children. They were young men, and they weren't just mocking him and making fun. They were coming after him.
Threatening his life.
Yeah, they were coming after him with baseball bats and sticks and machetes, and a couple of them probably had shotguns. And it was, and it just becomes this, they just... So if they don't want to be confronted with anything in the belief system that's unpleasant to them, they just won't be confronted by it.
Yeah.
There is this kind of self-protective, shield that they put up. Okay, we've got a caller on the air. 15 more minutes of the show. Get those calls in. And we'll try and take them. And, of course, tv@atheist-community.org is our viewer email address, too, right? So let's see what... Hi, you're on the air.
Hello there.
Hi.
Hi. How y'all doing?
We're okay.
Oh. Great. Hey, I believe everybody got to make up their own mind, and get the evidence to make a decision. And, the Bible is the true word of God, and people can accept it or not accept it. We get a lot of feedback on it.
Yeah,
sorry about that.
It's been happening all throughout the show. They have a brand new telephone system in, and it creates a lot of sound distortion. Sorry about that, but if you speak up, we'll hear you.
Okay, but the Bible is literally a literal book, except for metaphors and something.
So it's literal except when it's metaphors. Okay, either it's literal or it's not. I mean, if that's... Well, right. I mean, we understand that to believers, the Bible is the Word of God. We know that. I mean, we know that that's what believers believe.
Right. And like when Jesus said, He is the door. We all know that He's not a wooden door, but He is the only way to the Father, you see. And yet, some people are calling in about prophecies and making fun of Christians. When they don't really know what they're saying, because all the prophecies in the Bible that are coming true or have already come true.
Well, the thing, here's the problem with prophecy, right? Is that a lot of prophecies, the thing about them is that when they are written in vague poetic language, that has undergone at least 20 centuries of reinterpretation and retranslation. It is very easy to take an ancient prophecy, for one thing, and look at a current present-day event, and do what's called retrofitting, where you take a modern-day event and you plug it into a prophecy that it seems to apply to. And that doesn't just happen with Bible prophecies. It happens with guys like Nostradamus and people who think that the Aztec calendar says the world is going to end on a certain day, and what have you. So that's one very easy way to make it appear as if ancient prophecies come true. Another easy way to make it appear as if ancient prophecies come true is that if someone is a devout believer and they know a prophecy exists, that person can choose to deliberately fulfill the prophecy. So that isn't hard either. But the problem that you have if you want to determine that it was a prophecy really a true prophecy, that is, did the person who wrote this thing X many years ago actually have some way of envisioning the future for certain and made this statement knowing that it was correct at the time, how can you conclude that? How can you determine that just because a prophecy appears to have been fulfilled by an event that happened later on, how can you backpedal on that and say, yes, that's evidence that at that time of the writing, there was an actual supernatural influence over the person writing that prophecy that enabled them to see the future and to see an actual future event and predict it with complete accuracy. I think that by its very nature, that's just unverifiable. That's not something that you can really support with anything in the way of testable evidence. So at best, prophecy is, again, something that I think can really be best explained by things like believers just retrofitting current events to old prophecies. And a lot of old prophecies are like that because many of them, I think, reflect trends in culture. And again, a lot of them reflect the desires of believers to have certain things happen to their benefit that they're gonna fulfill. But then again, there have been so many people saying this passage in the Bible predicts that the end of the world is going to happen at this time, and then that date arises and the world doesn't end. So, you know, either prophecy works if there's actually a supernatural influence over people's minds enabling them to see the future, then it's going to work either 100% of the time or it's not going to work 100% of the time. It makes no sense to say there's some all-powerful divine being enabling me to prophesy the future or providing me with a prophecy of the future, telling me and saying, oh, but the divine being got it right in this instance but didn't get it right in this other instance. That just doesn't make a whole lot of sense.
Well, the disciples, you know, they all died except one, and they could have lived if they had just admitted that they didn't believe in Jesus Christ.
Yes,
and all the miracles he did.
Yes, but there's
prophecies.
There's a problem, though. There is a prophecy in Matthew, I believe it's chapter 28, where Jesus himself tells his disciples that the kingdom of God will happen on the earth. You know, his second coming will happen in the earth within their lifetimes. He said, there are some of you here present that will not taste of death before all these things come to pass. Okay,
well,
so there, Jesus himself... Okay, well, I mean, we can find this...
It's in the Bible. So.
Okay, but it is Jesus prophesying that essentially that the kingdom of God will arise on the earth and all will be well within their lifetimes.
You know? So unless they got a 2,000-year-old prophet, you know, disciples still crawling around somewhere.
Yeah. So
that one fell down.
I think that subsequent history proves that nothing in the way of the kingdom of a divine kingdom of God, at least not
true,
as the Bible tells us it's going to fall into place, happened within the lifetimes of those disciples.
Yeah.
You know, before they died around, you know, what, you know, the year 50 or something, the last of them. Who knows? So, again, a prophecy is just one of these things that I think is by its very nature unverifiable.
Well, if you go back and study that, you can understand it if you, pray about it and really...
Of course you can. Yeah, I mean, if you
can convince yourself of anything.
I mean, if you go into it from the perspective of, I'm someone who is predisposed to believe this, and I will pray about it and come up with a way that I will convince myself it's true, of course you will be able to do that. But I think if you're looking at it from... You know, I think the dispassionate perspective that somebody who is really doing an honest scientific investigation of the world, without going into it with an agenda, without a preconceived notion in mind, it's not a verifiable, you know, prophecy just isn't verifiable, I think, by its nature.
Well, I could come up with all kind of evidence and everything, and you could too if you had done your homework about what you're talking about.
Well, sir,
but
I mean, I've mentioned things that the Bible actually says, okay? I mean, I'm clearly not somebody who doesn't know what, I mean, who's...
We've been talking to callers and taking questions like this for many, many years.
Yeah, I mean, we have studied, I was raised in the church, I've studied these religions, I've read the Bible, I've read Christian apologetics, okay? We're not just coming from a talking out of our hat perspective here. I mean, I'm sorry that the things we're saying are in disagreement with your beliefs, but that's just how debate works.
Well, would you be interested in having a debate on TV?
Well, that's why we're here,
sir. That's what this is.
Yeah, that's what the show is for. We've been on the air for now over 5 years, and we've taken calls from folks like yourself, and we're here to debate these issues.
Well, my friends in Christian Answers, they want to debate you for years, and y'all haven't showed up.
Christian Answers, I've never heard from anyone from an organization with that name.
Don't know them.
But, you know, we'll go ahead and we'll put the viewer email address back on. If they want to get in touch with us, they can write that email address, and we'll be delighted to consider any questions that they have to ask us. But look, you know, feel free to call us back anytime and take us to task about stuff where you think we're wrong, because that's why we're here.
Well,
fair enough.
What I'm saying, you know, if you really want to give up your way of living,
what?
We don't. We like this. We have no reason to give up our way of living. It's pretty good as it is.
Yeah, I mean, what makes you think that we do this show because we have this desire to give up the way we're living and live another way?
Do you think we have some kind of awful life here?
Yeah,
you love it because you don't have a higher authority to be accountable to.
Okay.
That's right. Okay. I'm going rape and pillage when the show is over. He's going to join me.
Yeah, this would be the higher authority that sends bears to massacre children, correct? Why would I hold myself accountable to that sort of higher authority when that higher authority, in my estimation, is not morally superior to me in any way? You know, that's not a moral authority that I care to hold myself accountable to. However, I am accountable to my fellow human beings in the culture in which they live. And that is sufficient. And, you know, that is how civilizations thrive.
Well,
you know,
God gives you a choice to be obedient or not to be obedient.
Yeah, well, I think,
I don't like being a pet, though.
You know, Saddam Hussein gave his people that choice, too, and look what happened to him.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's not always the recommendation of how, authority should manifest itself. Well, anyway, sir, we're out of time, but please feel free to call us back anytime that's on the show and challenge us on anything, all right? But we're fresh out of time. The show's about over, okay? Thanks very much for your call.
Okay, have a great day.
You, too. You take care. Have a good week.
Bye.
Well, you know, that's what it is. I think we have time to take one question from Robert, and then if we don't get around to all of it, he can write us. Hey, you're on the air. Thanks.
Hey, do you guys believe in evolution?
No, we don't believe in evolution.
Okay, do you believe in the soul? Do you believe we possess a soul or a spirit?
If you're talking about some sort of supernatural floating ghostly thing inside
my
body,
definitions.
I don't have any evidence for it, sorry.
Okay, well, if we don't have a soul, then what gives us emotion? Why do we cry? Why do we laugh? Why do we sympathize with people's problems?
Gray matter.
Well,
That doesn't make any sense, what you just said.
Well, I mean, it's in our brains, right? I mean, it's in our minds are wired the way they are, and we have the... I'm not a neurologist, for one thing, okay? So I can't give you the medical explanation.
Right, and I can't give you any answers either.
I mean, I don't know if you saw earlier on the program, but we had a caller very early on, who we talked about, he brought up questions about, like, the evolution of intelligence.
Uh-huh.
And the evolution of, emotions and reason and why it is that we developed this niche. And like I said, we gave him like the web links and the stuff like that, but we're really not the guys to answer that question. But it's an interesting field to study.
I've seen so much compelling evidence to disprove evolution, and I've seen evidence on their side saying,
like what? Like what would be one?
Oh,
in 2 minutes?
I couldn't even get into it right now. There's, you know, you only got 3 minutes left on your show, but, you know, we cry, we laugh, you know, our emotions. I mean, that just seems like that wouldn't come from just nowhere.
Well, is this evolution? Yeah. Evolution doesn't say things come from nowhere. It says that.
Says we all evolved from gases and, you know, Big Bang and.
Not necessarily.
That's a vast oversimplification of the facts.
Yeah. Look, again, the talkorigins.org website. Well, I think the facts on that site will answer, I think, a lot of your questions fundamentally about what evolution says. And from a biological perspective, we know what happens. We know that the gene frequencies in organisms adapt to their environment and they change over time. So there's no real dispute that biologically organisms evolve. And as far as how do specific organisms find their niche and fit into it, and why do some become intelligent and create civilizations and others don't, that's an ongoing field of study, and it's very compelling, and it's very much active. And but at least that it's working to find answers as opposed to just making up a supernatural source and saying, well, I think it must be this because that just seems to make more sense to me. But anyway, thanks a lot, and call us back sometime, and You know, check the experts. I mean, ask a biologist about evolution, okay?
Okay.
Take care. All right. Thanks again to our stalwart crew and everybody in the control room. And at the very end, the last caller, we could hear him, and he wasn't burbling on us. So hopefully the phones will be better off next time. We're here every Sunday, 4:30 p.m. Tuesdays, 4:30 p.m. reruns. What else am I missing? And TV at atheist-community.org. Write us a letter and yell at us. And we'll read you on the air if it's cool.
Send us that hate mail we've been looking for.
Thanks, Ashley. Theists, we don't hate you. We just think you're wrong.